any other web sources. So then why, yeah, exclusive programs like this are required? The answer is very simple. Now we know climate is changing, the impacts are there, we need to mitigate. Here, in this program, to fulfill the mandate of UGC STRIVE, that is capacity building, all the participants need to develop the capacity to identify a research problem related to climate change, biodiversity, with reference to environmental impacts. Identify any one problem based on the lectures going to be delivered by various experts. So today I'm going to talk about invasion ecology related to climate science. If any one of the participant is interested about biological invasion, take up the idea. Look into your own ecosystem or your local or regional level. Develop with multidisciplinary, you mean the transdisciplinary, there is no border. So here in this program, we designed economists from various institutions going to address you how the economy is influenced by the climate change. Not only the economy, the physical sciences, biological sciences, and ecology, economy, we are bringing all the expertise into a single platform. So make use of this. At the end, you have to submit your proposal with reference to climate change, with reference to your own region. We will correct the proposal. We will make arrangement to have a collaboration. We link you with expertise related to climate change science. So that all the speakers are going to have eminence in their own research area. So this is up to you to use. Don't come, open the link and leave the computer for some other purpose. So take this a serious exercise. Definitely you will be having a bright future as far as the climate science is concerned. So our center is approaching a 5-module program. First module is summer and winter schools. Second program, we are also going to offer skill development programs. And the third one is the internship. And fourth one is visiting fellowships. And the fifth one is research projects. So this year, we are working on changing climate, environment, and biodiversity. So this platform will help you to understand the climate science. It will help you to design a research problem for your personal research. This platform will definitely be useful to you to write a research proposal for your future career. So, but you have to be sincere, you have to take sincere efforts to achieve the target. So, overall, the objective of the program and center is nationally a team of young researchers will be need to be trained in the focused area. We will be providing you theoretical, technical, and hands-on training from various experts to achieve the goal of the program. So overall, the beneficiary need to be public, science writers, academicians, postgraduate students, scientists and research scholars, and moreover, all the general public also need to be get benefited from this program. So I will conclude this one, and I am moving to the presentation that is going to be how the climate change going to influence the invasion. Fine. Together. So actually, our the keynote speaker gave elaborate lecture about the climate change and the issues. Most of the speakers are going to start with how the climate is going to influence climate change impact on economy, ecology, biodiversity, and so on. So here, this is a climate action trackers report. Briefly, only one slide. Actually, after the Industrial Revolution, we increased the temperature by around 1.5 degrees Celsius. To sustain the same, we need to take many innovative initiatives to tackle or to retain the current temperature rise. Today, we have one speaker from United States of America. He will be telling you how the renewable energy sources and renewable energy plays vital role keeping the Paris Accord. So with these few words, there are certain countries critically acting on climate target. Some countries are taking steps, but no typical model country is there to reduce the carbon emission or to the parameters to retain the temperature rise. So now there are two school of thoughts. One is, yeah, the climate is changing, but organisms also can adapt or respond. The another school of thought is, yes, organisms can adapt, but the level of changes happening around us higher than the expected level. There are three important papers right now. You can search the net or you can take these papers. One is published in Nature Communication, that is adaptive responses of animals to climate change are most likely insufficient. That means organisms may not cope up. That means all the organisms may not cope up with the changing climate. The another paper that is in National Geographic Journal, some animals can adapt to climate change, just not fast enough. The another title is climate change is happening too quickly for species to adapt. All the titles telling you only one thing. Climate is changing, organisms are adapting, but the level is going to be very slow or not matching with the changing climate. Most of the time it's happening mismatch. The arrival of migratory birds from polar to the tropical region should overlap the insect emergence, or otherwise adult insect emergence need to be coincide. If not, the birds may not survive. So the mismatching also happening. So now we are moving to what is bioinvasion? Why it is so important? The continental drift has taken place more than about 65 million years ago. This continental drift played vital role in speciation that we know. Because of the natural barriers, organisms cannot cross from one place or to another place or one continent to another continent because of the natural barriers. Now, due to the movement of humans from one continent to another continent, one country to another country, one geographical location to another geographical location, not only we are simply moving, we are taking some organisms also along with us. Rabbits are not native to Australia. Actually, a Britisher introduced 12 rabbits taken from Europe to Australia 100 years back. What happened? The 12 rabbits multiplied into 12 millions in Australia in 100 years. That means the invasion going to be havoc to most of the natural native ecosystems. Our Indian myna is going to be one of the worst invasive species in Australia and New Zealand. So we are introducing one organism from one place to another place, one continent to another continent. So the invasive species may be defined as an alien species which become established in natural or semi-natural ecosystems or habitat in an agent of change and threaten native biodiversity. So this is so important because this is the second greatest threat to biodiversity. People are introducing intentional introduction, that is for a definite purpose. We introduced an alga called Capophagus alvarezi to most of the tropical marine ecosystems to produce carrageenan. Unintentional introductions, the most popular example is Parthenium. It was introduced accidentally into the Indian subcontinent. Now it is one of the worst weeds in the world. So some organisms are introduced for aesthetic purpose. Some of them are used as biocontrol agent. So these organisms adapt to new environment and they take the entire native ecosystem and causing problems to the introduced region. What will happen for these or those introduced exotic organisms due to climate change? Climate change may result in human behavior, abiotic conditions, biotic interactions, all may happen. These changes may result or may favor new pathways. Actually, originally, the organisms are introduced traditional means through shipping, through transportation, or through conventional methods. Now, people are using online mode. By a single click, you can order any organism from any region to the other region. Those new pathways may emerge. So these climate change may create adverse environmental conditions. Adverse environment conditions may not favor to the susceptible native population, but at the same time, it is going to support the exotic invasive organism. I am going to tell you our case study. There is a fish called Pterycoplicetes pardalis. Actually, in most of your fish tanks will be having this species as your tank cleaner. This now invaded in most of the ecosystems in Tamil Nadu and rest of India also. And they are creating large, huge impact on fisheries and native fish population. We will see in the after few slides. So the new invasion pathways emerge, new species will adapt, then it will spread further and then the managing these invasive organisms are going to be a tough challenge. So the climate change favors invasive species is one school of thought. How at introduction level, climate change facilitates transport through higher intensity of extreme events. I will tell you, a flood can take many. Another case study, if time is there, we will discuss. Yeah, flood in 2004-05 in Madurai has washed many aquarium breeding sites. Many of the exotic breeds escaped from the fish tanks, from the breeding centers, and entered into the what you can say, the natural ecosystems. It happened. These organisms now established their own population in the natural ecosystems and causing large number of problems to the native ecosystems. You may not believe a single flood may vanish all aquarium breeding sites. They have taken the they may take the exotic organisms to the natural ecosystem. So now it is proved climate change resulted in most of the time resulted in floods. These floods may create new niches or new way of transporting the organisms. These transported organisms may again colonize and establish and further spread, may create havoc to the ecosystems where we experience. So the native range, this may not happen. The chance of escaping and establishment is going to be very not easy task for the native species. The climate change impacts, constraints, alterations and bioinvasion, if you take. So we can summarize, transport of exotic species through various new introduction mechanisms. Then the next step is going to be naturalization of exotic species. And the third is distribution of naturalized exotic species. And further, it's going to create impact. Impact in every aspect. These exotic species, most of the flowering, the beautiful flowering plants are going to be exotics. If you see around your building or the college or campus or your garden, most of them are going to be exotic nature. These plants are introduced mainly for ornamental purpose. These ornamental plants, you can see throughout the year, they are going to flower, produce flowers. So automatically, the most of the pollinators are going to visit the only the exotic species, not to the natives. And then we need to develop a overall management strategies by including invasion with what you can say the climate change. So altered mechanism of transport and introduction, the key hypothesis so I will tell you, first you have to have an idea about hypothesis. So all you participants should develop a hypothesis related to climate change. This climate change hypothesis need to be tested, and this tested hypothesis need to be published. We are definitely, Government of India will be happy. At least certain number of young researchers take up this climate science, biodiversity, environmental issues. So environment is not static, it's a dynamic. Still we are reading the book written by ecology by Eugene P. Wodak. Now the principles are the same, but the changes are inevitable. It's continuous. So we need to look the environment with fresh pair of spectacles rather than by looking old principles and old examples. So your hypothesis is very simple, a testable statement. You have to frame a simple hypothesis, how climate change or contemporary ecological issues need to be looked. So here, human-mediated transport, altered commercial or recreational activities, increase the propagule pressure. Propagule means any seed may be the propagule for propagation through seeds. Yes, stem cutting may be the propagule. Egg may be the propagule. So if more number of propagules are introduced repeatedly to the ecosystem, then the introduced organism have the more chances to become invasive. The survivorship of propagules during the transport will be enhanced. How? So your sipping mechanism changed. The sipping also favors the invasion. Longer sipping season will increase the number of voyages with non-native propagules. There will be more purposeful introduction for recreation or conservation purpose. Currently, we are working for a project sponsored by DST CERT, where we are studying how the online stores and the botanical gardens. Actually, every year, most of the botanical gardens are conducting annual flower shows. As best of our knowledge and data, we conclude that 95% of the flowering shows are harboring only the exotic species, not by the natives. These flower shows and the online stores are further enhancing the invasion episodes. The potential consequences are going to be very high. The altered climatic constraints on invasive species, unsuccessful non-native species will be able to colonize if conditions become more like the species' native range. So now we are altering the here I want to emphasize one thing. All the exotic organisms are not going to invade. There are some trees introduced during the British's period. In Madurai also we have Adansonia. It is not invaded anywhere. But some other species introduced a couple of years back, now they are dominating the entire ecosystem. There is one hypothesis explaining which species will become invasive. This is rule 10 hypothesis. If you are introducing 100 species, 10 species will establish. Out of this 10, one species will become invasive. Now, these changes may favor all the exotic species to become invasive. So that problem is there. So an example is white cloud mountain minnow, a aquarium trade fish, would be invade the Great Lake region of the temperature change in the lake. Altered distribution of existing invasive species. So now the cold temperature constraints of invasion may be overcome. These organisms can enhance their distribution into the newer regions. So now there are many strategies to contain the spread of invasive species. You can see there are organisms used to control one organism, that is called biocontrol. Now the picture Icaria grassips, you can see. Icaria grassips, we are using biocontrol agents to control this particular weed. Now what people are predicting, already established mechanisms may not work out now. because these organisms may behave differently. So management also going to be become problematic. So now you can see, we are going to create new niches for the invasion. We are going to make more pathways for invasion. We are going to have problems for the management also. So these are the important points. So these are the parameters going to influence the invasiveness: changing temperature, match mismatch. I told you, the flower will be opening, but the pollinator may not visit. So then the range shift will happen. If 1 degree Celsius temperature increase may force the organism to move from towards polar region. Then the ocean and air chemistry also going to change. Changing ocean circulation, climate variability create disturbances. Plant responding towards carbon dioxide concentration also going to change. Now I am coming to what we are doing currently on invasion. So this is about our aquatic marine invasion. Actually, we are working on a couple of projects sponsored by CSIR. This is one article we published in Current Science with cover photo. You can see. Actually, this alga introduced for commercial purpose. Now it escaped from the commercial site and invaded into most of the coral reefs. Now we are looking. We are working on coral bleaching. Actually, coral bleaching is almost now annual phenomena due to temperature rise. The zooxanthellae is moved from the coral, and the bleaching happens. What is the rejuvenation opportunity is not given, because these exotic alga immediately occupying the zooxanthellae. So that means the resilience is become more otherwise impossible due to the climate change. This is another a problem. Actually, we are working on the project supported by ICMR. This Icarnia and sustainable mosquito population status. Here, double impact. Icarnia is the only aquatic plant can survive all the conditions. It can maintain the propagules. It can lure the pollinator, because the flowers are going to attract large number of honeybees. It supports the mosquito population, both adult and imbecues. Finally, the climate is going to support both vector and the invasives. This is going to be more dangerous than the single impact. This is another organism currently we are working, and that is giant African snail Echinata falcia. So from 2014-15 onwards we are monitoring this. This is the case study what I told. This is going to be our model organism. So in the slide you can see in the right top some discarded fish specimens. One day we crossed the lake, that is a mesotrophic lake located in Madurai. We felt a stringent smell along the banks of the entire lake. So then we visited and we found that they thrown some fish. Then we inquired about that fellow, why you are not selling this fish? So then he told that, sir, this is not edible. So then we asked him, so we also coming with you for fishing. So then we ventured into the fishing activity. One fine morning, 4:30 we returned from the fishing site, and we found that most of the fish what they caught is going to be Pterychophilus pardalis. So then we try to find out which species it is. So with the help of aquarium specialist, we found that it's a native of Amazon River Basin. So introduced for what you can say, clean the tank, fish tank cleaner. So then we further intensified our research. Actually, the entire lake infested with this particular fish species. Then we approached the state government of Tamil Nadu Planning Commission, also requested us to take up this project, and we worked for them. Almost there are three major river basins in Tamil Nadu: Kaveri, Vaigai, and Tamrapurani. We visited almost our entire stretch, and we found that entire river basins invaded by this particular species. Then the question is, let it be. Actually, it is not edible. It won't permit the native species to grow. It is creating the right side, you can see the tunnels created by this fish. Each fish can produce thousands of eggs. We counted up to 8,000 eggs per matured female per season. So the entire tank is filled with this particular species. Okay, sir, how it related to climate change? So this particular one fish, without water, it can survive in the hot sun up to 18 to 19 hours. You can imagine how hard this fish is. It can survive all the pH levels. It can survive all the temperature levels. It can survive all the polluted ecosystems. So now you can imagine this one fish going to be there in the entire aquatic ecosystems. The climate change, the quality, water quality changes going to happen in the future, also going to favor this one particular species rather than others. This is a popular aquarium catfish native to South America, established throughout the world through aquarium trade. Their feeding behavior and burrowing activities cause considerable damage, compete with native fish population. So you can see in the fish tank, the size is going to be only in centimeters, maybe 10 to 15 centimeters. So in the wild catch, it's going to be up to 60 centimeter in size, sometimes more than that also. So it is ruling the entire aquatic ecosystem in the invaded regions. So it is there everywhere. It's going to survive in the all climatic changes scenario. So currently we are working on how the climate models, through climate models, how this species is going to expand its range to the newer niches, because almost all our water bodies are polluted now, either industrial waste or from domestic waste. These new niches and the ecosystems are being exploited by this particular species. So then it's quite natural. One day the person fishing in the ecosystem, in the lake, he asked us, give me some solution for this. So then we told them, we can go for all out search, completely removing all the adults and waiting for the next season. So nothing happened. Every season it can maintain its own population. The eradication programs failed. and this is going to be one of the major problem in the in Tamil Nadu inland fishery. So I told you the online trade of exotic organisms, SWOT of the Dormitils, it is published in Current Science maybe 2-3 years back, 2015. How there are thousands of organisms are being traded through online. You can order any organism by a single click, it will be delivered. Then the possibility of introducing these to native ecosystems also increased. This is you can see in most of the places in Kaveri, the water is black instead of blue. So because of these fish completely infested, they can even survive in the high flow region also. So the next aspect what we are working is going to be how the phenology of invasive species going to alter the avian fauna. Actually, the hypothesis is a vacant niche hypothesis. A vacant niche exotic species tend to bloom when native species are not in blooming condition or leave. The example what we working is the Prosopis juliflora. Actually, Prosopis juliflora introduced for fuel wood in India. Now it has become an extensive invaded region in South India, not only South India, the entire India. Actually, this work carried out in a bird sanctuary that is called Vetamudi Bird Sanctuary in Tamil Nadu. Actually, this particular plant species, that is Prosopis juliflora, it's evergreen. So the migratory birds, what they feed, the leafy greeny cover will protect the nest from the predator. So naturally, the native trees are not giving this that much greeny appearance for them. So then the birds are lured by this Prosopis juliflora. And most of the what you can say, birds are putting their nest in the Prosopis juliflora rather than our native Acacia niloticum. So this particular tree may not support large number of nest. The dropping, egg dropping is most common observation that we published as a paper in Scientific Correspondence in Current Science, that is impact of Prosopis juliflora on nesting success of breeding wetland birds or vetamudi bird sanctuary South India. So you can read this paper. There is another paper also, ecological and socio-economic impacts of Prosopis juliflora invasion in the semi-arid ecosystem in selected villages of Ramnad district. Actually, we are monitoring the dynamics of this particular species since 1993. Almost we have 30 years data, and still our monitoring is continue, and we are taking with along with climate parameters. So the next aspect is changing ocean circulation. Actually, we are not directly working on ocean circulation, but there are people going to talk to you. Now the marine plastics are going to be the most important topic now, because all the inland plastics taken by river, the pathway is very simple. We are discarding the plastics from our household to the nearby dustbin. Then dustbins are taken to somewhere to recycling site, yard, or thrown to the water bodies, because that water bodies are nobody's land. Anybody can dump anything. So nobody is going to put fine on you. So then every the plastic waste are thrown either directly to the marine ecosystem or carried through the river ecosystem to the marine. Now the marine is full of plastic debris. Now, what is happening? The plastic bottle thrown in Sri Lanka easily reaches India mainland. So we collected some bottles on the shore of Gulf of Mannar. So different origin, the printing itself you can see made in some country, not to the native region. That means there are many organisms, not only the plastics are coming. Instead, plastics along with exotic organisms are reaching different destinations. That is going to be the global problem. This is the last part. The carbon dioxide level going to influence the plant physiology in different way. Actually, there are two major photosynthetic pathway systems. One is C3, another one is C4. The C3 photosynthetic pathway evolved first when the carbon dioxide level was much higher in the air. The C4 pathway is most recent one, but efficient one. Our sugarcane is C4 plant. Now, due to sudden increase of climate change, there are many C4 plants losing its capacity to fix the carbon. So you can imagine, without sugarcane, you cannot provide sugar to the entire world. So now that also going to happen in a couple of decades. So we have to, one or another way, influenced by climate change in the future. There are some reports saying that the scientists blame climate change for bacteria that causes the mysterious death of 300 African elephants. New research suggests Burmese python will find a little suitable habitat outside South Florida. All models will help you to understand the problem, but models are not going to give any solution. They will give you some projections, but we need to learn the models also. So, with these few points, I will conclude my the first lecture. I think I will come to you in future also.
Hello.
Yeah, sir.
No. It's continuing, sir.
Yeah. Any now I would thank you for patient listening, sir. Any questions or any discussions we can have?
Yes, sir. I am amazed by your presentation because many people think that it is all thrown away. Who cares about those things thrown away from the lake? And your particular view about protecting the nature and the environment of a particular water body is very important to consider, sir. And also, you blended rightly with the science and the sociological aspect also, what the stride is intended for. So that I was actually, as a communication teacher, we got some more information from you from this presentation. I think that you had a right way looked upon the issue, which is actually a menace because large number of aquarium and how to throw away the waste, or otherwise if we sometimes think that it is waste, but it may grow somewhere and destroy the existing system, in the sense it will not be afforded to the society. So that's what our observation. I wanted to wish you that the presentation was very good. That's what, sir.
Thank you, sir. Any other questions from other participants? I think most of you going in between and coming at the last, your data source. So, no discussion, any questions? Okay. Unmute and ask. Kannan, Kannan, you can ask your question. Left arm. He may join. Yeah, please. Maithili, you have some questions?
Yes, sir. I do have questions.
Yeah, please.
Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for the informative session.
Okay.
I have one question, sir. Is there any species which are existent, going upon existent due to this climate change or this invasiveness, bio invasion?
Yeah. Actually, it's a very, very, very good question. We may not be knowing the future climate. We are predicting. There are a couple of parameters we are predicting. For example, the salinity going to increase in the marine ecosystem because of the climate change or temperature rise. So the temperature rise may increase the salinity indirectly or directly. So then what happened? The organism can survive in the higher salinity, only can proceed further. So that means the wider adaptable organisms will survive in the future. The prediction models will help you to take many parameters at one platform. For example, TDS level, salinity level, and the nitrogen deposition level, all biotic interactions and abiotic parameters, if we consider, definitely we can find which species going to survive in the future. So there are many exotic organisms. What we have as of now, the data, are wider adaptability and tolerance level. For example, a plant will be pollinated by insect. If not insect, they can pollinate by themselves, self-pollination. So then, if not, so they can propagate through the rosettes, I mean vegetatively. So they are having three options. The option one, failure, the option two will help. If option two goes, then option three will help. So those species, for example, Icarnia. Icarnia will be surviving in all climatic conditions in the tropical region. They are similarly, we can find many more organisms also. I think I answered your question, or?
Yes, sir. I got it, sir. Thank you, sir.
Any other question? Kannan, he wants to answer, wants to ask some question. Every session, kindly give your feedback. That will help us to further improve, and it will help us to design more effective programs in future. So the link was provided in the chat box. So kindly fill and return it. So we are arranging the speakers with all difficulties. So I request all the participants, please kindly attend, enrich your knowledge, have a contact. So that will help you, that will make you, that will give you a bright future and a good scientist to the country and to the society. This is the question answer.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
This is the question.
Yeah, the Kannan, he posted the question. Okay. Nisha Gupta. Yeah. Sir, like this invasive fish, we have many species which had led to loss of many species. So is there any way to get rid of it? And sir, why this invasive species which comes from somewhere else got dominated over all climatic conditions? Why not the native ones? Yeah, there are two questions asked by Nisha Gupta. We have Yeah. So far, our management programs not very encouraging. Once invaded, it is very difficult to remove them. In most of the cases, the scientific publications and our own experience gave only discouraging results. So once invaded, it is very difficult to remove them because of the adaptability of the species. For example, we are to get rid, we are using three approach. One is chemical. Chemical means it's going to be not specific. Chemicals are not available. They are going to be only generic. So then it's going to affect the entire ecosystem, whether it's going to be terrestrial or aquatic. So chemical, most of the time, we have to rule out. The second one is biological control. Biological control, sometimes it works. Only the prickly pear study in Australia is the only encouraging, or otherwise there is one typical case study. We in Kerala waters, we can find similar to Icarnia, a telophyte, which fern that is not Asola, some other Pistia. Pistia in Ghana, they introduced one insect to control Pistia. You may not believe, in 1 year, they almost eaten up millions of tons of Pistia. The same insect was introduced in India. What happened? They never touched Pistia. They went to some other edible crops. So it is very difficult to use biological control also, because they may switch over the coast at any point of time. So the third one is mechanical. Currently what we are practicing most of the places, but it's going to be time consuming, a lot of energy and money involved. So in Tamil Nadu, a couple of years back, we started removing prosopis in many of the ecosystem. Now actually they came back with more vigorous than the pre-removal stage. So as of now, all the three programs were not encouraging, but people still trying with a specific level. So the second question, what Nisha Gupta asked, why these invasive species which come from somewhere else and got dominated? Yeah, it's very nice question. Actually, every organism, the basic instinct of life is reproduce to establish its population. So there are many hypotheses explaining why these the introduced species have advantage over natives. The new introduced environment going to be enemy-less. The enemies are not going to be there for the new introductions. So I may be having enemy only in my own building or in my own campus. So if I come to your place, there will be no enemy, at least for some point of time. Then I can invest all my energy for some other purpose. Similarly, the invasive organisms are diverting all the defense energy to the reproduction and enhancing its population before the natural enemy evolves. That is one reason. The another one is there are many empty niches. The empty niches, unoccupied niches, are occupied by the introduced organisms. So, in some cases, the similar conditions from the same conditions existing in the native range also, for example, the South Africa is similar to Indian tropical climate. It supports our neem plant. Neem is supposed to be the medicinal plant here. Yeah. I think I answer the questions of Nisha, I think. The Kannan Vaidyanathan, he asked, what are ultimate solution or challenge we have in dealing with invasives? Always we have prevention is better than cure. So we have hereafter we have to be very cautious. We have to create awareness among the students community, among the society. So don't introduce new organisms for any purpose. So most of the organisms are introduced for lesser purpose. This tank cleaner, no way people are connected with the introduced pathway is entirely different. It's a lesser purpose. But the sufferers are the folk fishermen and the society in the rural areas. So therefore, the challenge we can take as a society, and we can minimize new introductions, and I think we can mitigate the future invasion episodes. Yeah, solution as of now, you all young researchers, it's up to you. There are many, this is where we were students like you or young researchers, these much facilities are not available. Now there are many, the AI platform is there. So you will hear a lecture from my colleague, Dr. Anbarasan is going to give you how artificial intelligence will help you to solve or take up new initiatives in climate change science. So we hope we are giving you the present condition. The future may be decided by you. Yeah, another question, Sopna Ray. Inside a protected area, what are the precautions protected area authority can take to reduce the invasive effect? Yeah, it's a fantastic question. Actually, so already most of the protected ecosystems already invaded. The Western Ghats invaded by Lantana camera, Cromolina odorata, and many protected ecosystems are with invasive species only. But people are, after our paper, I show you now, the paper entitled Influence of Rosaphis juliflora on Nesting Behavior of the Birds. The authority immediately, that was the only paper, immediately implemented. Our lab was so happy at the time, because all the exotic trees in that particular sanctuary was removed. Only now the native trees are there. The now the bird diversity and the reproduction at the end of the reproductive season increased drastically. So the another question is, do we have any policy to curb invasive species specific to our country concerned? Yeah, it's a wonderful question. Yeah, we have policies now, but different policies for different ministries. There are some ministries we have to promote commerce. Sometimes we have to promote the biodiversity conservation. So now people are trying to develop unified protocol for the introduction of exotic species. I think in future, yeah, single platform introductions will be coming soon. Step taken to control exotic species already in our forest? Yeah, mechanical mode we are trying, but it's going to be only temporary relief. If my memory is correct, in 1950, forest in Vithagar or some eminent forest policymaker developed a protocol to remove Lantana camera from the entire Western Ghats of India. At that time, my memory is correct, they calculated about around 850 crores. So that was almost equivalent to Indian government budget at the time. So that much huge money required to control mechanically. If not, one place to another place, these exotic organisms, I told you, multiple mode. Lantana camera can spread through water, can spread through birds also, helping seed dispersal. Vegetatively they can. So one or another mode, they will invade again. Moreover, these invasive species having plant, if they are plants, they can seed bank. The seed bank can survive years together. even I told you the eggs of the Tergopolitis pardalis fish can survive entire cold season, I mean the summer season, and they can again catch out during the next rainy season. Those kind of mechanisms are adapted by these invasives. That's why we have more fear about these invasives. These invasives can survive and sustain any harsh environment. What we are going to see the next generation climate conditions.